you. I thank you for yet another opportunity to stand before these your people to present the word. I pray, Lord God, that even now, so that you would empty me of myself and you would fill me up with you, that what I say would not be my words, but that which you have wished to be carried to your people. So have your way within me, your chosen vessel this day. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
It is indeed an honor and a privilege to stand before you, God's people, and to present the word. I thank God for my pastor, my first lady in her absence, the clergy team, and the whole church family. I just thank everyone here. I thank you for using this time to come here to be in this place and to hear a word from this preacher. As always, I would be remiss if I didn't say I thank my wife and my kids, because as I always stand to say, they hear it and they witness it and they deal with it long before you do. And they do so with a gracious and kind heart. So I thank them. And for those that are watching on YouTube and Instagram and Pinster and all the other social media networks, thank you for joining us. Thank you for being here. Let's go break the scripture. Let's look at Mark chapter 9, verse 14 through 27. And before I go a little further, hi, Mom. She told me she was going to tune in this day. Mark, chapter 9, starting at verse 14. And when they came to the disciples, they saw a great multitude about them, and the scribes questioning with them. And straightway all the multitude, when they saw him, were greatly amazed, and running to him, saluted him, and asked them, what questions you with them? And one of the multitude answered him, Teacher, I have brought unto you my son, who hath a dumb spirit, and wheresoever it taketh him, it dashes him down, he foameth at the mouth, he grindeth his teeth, and he pineth away. And I speak to the disciples that they should cast it out, and they were not able to. And he answered them, saying, O faithless generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I bear with you? Bring him to me. And they brought him unto him. And when he saw him, straightway the spirit tear him grievously, and he fell on the ground and wallowed foaming. And he asked his father, How long is it since he hath been having this spirit? And the father answered, Since he was a child. And oftentimes it hath cast him about into the fire and in the waters to destroy him. But if thou canst do anything, have compassion on us and help us. And Jesus said unto him, If thou canst, all things are possible to him that believe. Straightway the father of the child cried out and said, I believe, but help my unbelief. And when Jesus saw that the multitude came running together, he rebuked the unclean spirit and saying unto him, Thou dumb and deaf spirit, I command thee, come out of him and enter no more. And having cried out and tore him much, he came out of the boy, and the boy became as one that is dead, insomuch that the more part of them said that he is dead. But Jesus took him by the hand and raised him up, and he arose. I want to give a topic for this morning. Where is your voice? Where is your voice? How do you find voice in today's world? How do you find voice inside of yourself? How do you find it a possibility to be able to do what it is that God would desire of you? Where and how do you speak? What sounds do you make? What comes out of you that proclaims who Jesus is? Where is your voice? In the onset of our text, we find the disciples in a heated debate with a crowd and with those that were the clerks or the law keepers. It was those that had the charge of writing the text, making sure that every letter of the law was followed in the text. What the scribes' job was as they would take notes or take dictation, they would make sure that everything was in order. The scribes of the earlier days, when they was writing the text, whenever they made a mistake, the whole text had to be discarded. They would burn it. They would go then purify themselves and start rewriting the text. That's why they were always found in conjunction with the Pharisees. You see, what they did was made sure that those that were Pharisees was keeping the law properly. The scribes had an important role. They made sure that the letter of the law was being followed. So it made me ask a question. So why are they following a crowd? They were law keepers. They were leaders in government, in the Jewish council. They held positions of power. Why were they following behind a crowd? Have you ever been faced with a situation that was unbearable? Have you ever been in a spot where it seemed like you just couldn't make it on your own? The disciples was in that kind of situation now. See, Jesus was away. Jesus was on the mountain of transfiguration. He had pulled away for a little bit. He was showing some other disciples some deeper secrets. And the other disciples that were left were down in the valley when the Father comes up and bringing his Son. See, they attempted to do what they had done before. Have you ever tried that? Have you ever been good at something for a long time? Then all of a sudden, a hard situation come up, and you try to go into this new situation doing the same things that you did in the old situation. Could you picture the scene? The disciples are there. The boy is there. The father is there. The scribes are there. Everybody in the scene had voice, except for the boy. The little boy had no voice. His problem, his condition was that he could not speak. Every time he went to raise his voice, every time he went to speak, the demon would grab him and gnash him and turn him and twist him. The disciples did what they used to do. I could see them talking amongst themselves. What did you do last time? Well, when Jesus sent me out, what I said was, demon, come out, and the demon just fled. So do it. Demon, come out. Demon's still inside. What did you do? Well, I grabbed some water and I splashed it on him and I said, demon, be gone. And he fled. Do it. He did it. And demon's still inside. And they were not able to do what they used to do, so it caused them to get into an argument. Church, don't you know that the world oftentimes will come to you? And when you're not able to perform on call and do what you used to do, it becomes a place or a point of argument. Why do they keep knocking on your door? Because in the past, you was always dependable. Yeah. See, in the past, they know that they could come to you for a miracle. In the past, they knew that they could come to you for a blessing. In the past, they knew that they could come to you and you would solve their problems. You would give them a handout. You would be able to do it. You've always done it in the past. Why can't you do it now? It becomes a point of tension. It causes conflict. church. Go out like you used to go out, church. Handle what you used to handle for me, church. I was challenged as I read the text because it made me wonder how often people knock on my door expecting to receive from me what I don't have the ability to give.
Yes.
When you're giving and giving because God has blessed you, it's good. If God blessed you to give, give. If he blessed you to help, help. But you must realize that it's only by God's authority and God's power and God's ability in you are you able to do it. Let me give you some help. Matthew 10 and 1. Jesus sent the disciples out two by two, giving them power and authority over unclean spirits. Luke 9 and 1. Jesus sent the disciples out two by two, giving them power and authority over the unclean spirits. Mark 6, verse 7. Jesus sent the disciples out two by two, giving them power and authority over the unclean spirits. Now, in Mark 9, they don't have the power. Don't you know when you take it upon yourself to do what it is that God has not authorized you nor given you ability and or power to do, you find yourself in the midst of an argument, complaining and whining, God, why can't I do it? God, why isn't it getting done? God, I thought that you was able. God, I thought that you had the ability. God, I thought you gave me the power. We cannot function outside of the power or the stability, the label that God has given us.
Yes.
If God appoints you to it, you are able to do it. Right. But if you become self-appointed, self-approved, going under your own authority, going within your own name, going within your own power, you will find yourself in the midst of a conflict or being run off by demons.
Yes.
But look at the love of our Savior. Look at how wonderful our God is. He comes down from the mountain, greets the crowd, the scribes, his disciples, and the Father. He shows up and gives voice to the powerless.
Yes.
Don't you know that you have a God that when you are stuck, when you're in a situation, when you're in a place where it seems like you can't make your way out, God will show up and show out with his power.
Yes.
God will step in between you and that which is causing you conflict. When God comes on the scene, all focus is shifted off of you. And it shifted on him.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord.
Think about it. When everybody counted you out and you got yourself together and start to call on the Lord, all of a sudden, power came. God shows up and steps between you and that which was causing you distress.
Yes.
They still sitting there wondering, trying to figure out how did he escape? How did she get out? We had a bomb. We had a court. We destroyed them. We broke them up.
Jesus.
But God
yes.
shows up and steps between you and that which is causing you distress.
Yes.
See,
yes.
Jesus, when he came down, he didn't go and start talking to his disciples. He went and started talking to the scribes.
Yes.
Why are you questioning them? Why are you coming up against them? See, Jesus understands that the real question is not them, or the real problem is not them against you. It's them against him.
Yes.
That's why most of the time as believers, we run into struggle, we run into situations. It's not that the demon or the problem or the situation is coming up against us.
Yes.
It's coming up against the Jesus that's in us.
Yes.
And Jesus will stand up for you and ask the question, why are you questioning them?
Yes.
Why are you bothering them? I'm the the one that you have problems with. Why is your focus on dealing with getting at them? Come get with me. I'm the one you have a problem with. And it amazed me. It amazed me how Jesus will come and give voice to that which is powerless, or the one that is powerless. Jesus will stand in array against your enemies and defend you by being or becoming your voice. Why are you questioning them? Jesus understands the real battle. And the real battle is the world coming up against you. Why? Because they can come at you because they're afraid to deal with him. But if you're a believer and you're trusting God through all things, God will step in the middle and give you the powerless voice. So where's your voice? Where is it Jesus show up in your life? And one of the multitude answered and said, Master, I brought unto you my son, which has an unclean spirit, and wherever he taketh him, it teareth at him. He foameth and gnashes his teeth, and he becomes stiff as dead. And I spoke to your disciples, asking them to bring it out, and they weren't able to. When you're going out against demons to fight, and God doesn't give you the authority or the power to, you'll find yourself in a situation where you are powerless. Now I'll notice something else that drew my attention in the text. Jesus' response was not to the disciples. Jesus' response was not to the Father. Jesus' response was to the scribes and the crowd. Bear with me. Let's look at Jesus' response. Jesus' response was quite simple. What Jesus said was, why are you questioning them? Why are you bothering them? The Father explains the situation, the problem to Jesus. Then Jesus' response is, O faithless generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I suffer you? Bring him to me. Every time in the past when I read that text, I always pictured that Jesus was talking to his disciples. That Jesus was telling them, why? How long do I got to be with you that you have no power? How long do I got to speak with you and be around you and you don't understand who you're with? How long will you go with me and not have power? But what drew my attention to the text this time was the word faithless. How could you spend your life walking with Jesus and be considered faithless? How could you spend your time in the presence of the Master, doing what the Master has told you to do before, and be considered faithless? See, if you look deeply, spend a little time digging, what you'll find is that when Jesus came on the scene, it said that they saluted Jesus. Y'all read that earlier on in the text? Okay. They saluted him. See, I read the text in the past that they greeted him. They open-armedly welcomed him. They expected him to come. They wanted him to be there. But when I really looked at the text, the thing salute here meant folded arms. So when Jesus showed up, the crowd and the scribes took a position of folded arms. Y'all don't understand. Jesus shows up and they go, we're amazed. We just dealt with your disciples and now we're ready to deal with you, Jesus.
Okay.
They folded their arms in opposition to Jesus.
Yes.
So here when he's saying you faithless generation, he wasn't talking to his disciples. He was talking to those that were standing in opposition to him.
Yes.
So what that means for us, church, that we cannot stand in opposition to Jesus if we ever plan to have a clear voice.
Yes, yes.
If
yes.
we plan to have the power that God wants for us to have, we can't stand in opposition to what it is that God is trying to do. Jesus was speaking to those that had folded arms. They had prepared themselves. They had took a position, a post of opposition against the Savior.
Yes.
You see, they wasn't, the scribes and the crowd wasn't coming to see Jesus perform a miracle. They was coming as a challenge to Jesus' authority. The scribes came because they wanted to see if Jesus was going to follow every letter of the law. See, you got to do it. You got to do it the way the text says do it. You got to do it the way you've always done it. You can't go outside of these boundaries. Don't you know we set limitations on God in our own life? Trying to figure out why is it we can't do and get where God wants us to get to. Why? Because we are so busy looking at God with folded arms in opposition against what it is that he wants for us.
Yes.
Now, he's already told the disciples, told the crowd and the scribes that they were a generation that was untrustworthy, unbelieving, and unfaithful.
Yes.
That's a whole lot of knots, don't you think? Mm-hmm. How do you get in the presence of God and not trust him? Yeah. So he couldn't have been talking to disciples. He couldn't have been talking to believers. Do y'all believe Jesus and take him at his word, don't you?
Yeah.
Come on. Come on, we do, right?
Yes.
All right. I'm in the right place. We are the ones that will line up behind Jesus. We are the ones that desire to do the will of the Master. We are the ones that he gave power and authority to. But every once in a while, we may step out of line and think that it's about us. And God has to put us in a place that we can see that it's not about us.
Yes, yes.
So what does he do? He comes then and steps between us and what's causing us distress. Look at the love of our Savior. How he stood between that which is causing us pain and causing us suffering. I don't know. Maybe I got it wrong. I don't know. But is it a possibility that the Father understood this? That's why he had so much love for his son, that he wanted to get his son to a place where his son can get the help? Maybe it's possible that the Father said, I've dealt with this thing too long. I've struggled with it too hard. I've tried everything that I can do. Let me get this to Jesus. Now, there are those that would hear this and say, that was good for the Father. He did a good thing. He got his son into the presence of the disciples, and then he got his son into the presence of Jesus. When the son is brought before Jesus, the son goes into another convulsion.
Yes.
He just falls out. He just starts to cut up, as my mama would say. Look at how our God handles the situation. God did not even address the condition or the mannerism of the boy at first. What God had to do was change the focus of the father.
Uh-huh.
How long has he been like this? Since He was a child. Since he was little, he cut up like this. Since he was a baby, he acted this way. This thing was dealing with him. See, the fathers have spent the years with his child, loving his child, taking care of his child, making excuses for his child, trying his best to deal and manage the problems and situations of his child. So much so that Jesus had to take his focus off the child and put his focus on him.
Yes.
You see, Jesus shows up in the midst of your problems in order to give you voice. But before you can speak or have voice, you got to change the perspective of where you look at things. If Jesus, I believe, would have dealt with the problem first, without first speaking to the Father's focus never would have came on Jesus. Jesus shows up. Bring him to me. The boy is brought to Jesus. The boy falls out. And Jesus goes to the Father, shifts his focus, and starts talking directly to him. How long has he been like this? How long has this thing been trying to destroy him? How long has this thing been trying to kill him? How long has this thing been trying to take his life? If Jesus never would have shifted the man's focus, he would have done what he always did, safeguarded the son. Oh, let me help y'all. Let me help y'all. Sometimes we have problems in our life. And we cherish the problems in our life. We hold close to our bosom the problems in our life. We don't want nobody to touch it, look at it, move it, or even think about the problems in our life. The problems made me where I am and what I am today. I want the problems to be solved, but I'm not ready to let the problem go. That's why you can cry about it. You can pray about it. You'll fast about it. You'll bend over backwards for it, but you're still trying to provide what it needs to survive. You keep giving it your attention. You keep holding it close to your bosom. You have to be willing to surrender the problem to the hand of one who can truly fix it and deal with it. Don't be a part of that faithless generation. Have faith in Jesus.
Yes.
You came this far. You came already to this space. Why don't you let him perform the miracle that you truly desire for him to do? I know that there's someone out there that's saying, but that's good for them. I don't really want to deal with this problem. I don't even want to confront and face this problem. There has been a study performed, and what they found that those that were traumatized as a child, their brain somehow has been wired and fixated on that spot, that time, that moment when they were traumatized. So they grow up physically able and capable of doing, but whenever a stressful situation comes or anything that triggers that emotion inside of them shows up, they go back to being that little child. That's why we have grown men acting like little boys. Because there was something in their childhood that caused them to be linked and stuck there. They haven't had the opportunity mentally to grow up. They were stuck there. Now, for us here, sometimes we become spiritually stuck. We've been fixated in one spot far too long. We've given this problem our time. We've given it our prayers. But the minute someone tries to touch it, speak about it, hold it, take it away from you, tell you to lay it down, you start holding it even closer. Every week we come to the altar where you're supposed to lay down or cast your cares before the Lord, and some of us walk away with the same cares that we had when we came up. Because I know this thing. Don't you know that you can't hold on to a problem or a secret for so long? Because sooner or later, it will kill you. It's already been assigned to destroy you. And it's going to do its very best to break you. That's why every time you come to that place where you think that you're about to get over it, you find yourself going backwards and starting all over again. You're struggling with it because you have no voice. The Father brought the young man to Jesus because the Father cared enough to give him voice. And the Father knew that if he could get him into the hands of Jesus, that Jesus would speak to his situation and change it. The problem oftentimes cast the boy down, oftentimes caused him to foam at the mouth, oftentimes tried to throw him in fire and in the water to destroy him. The Father loved the Son so much so that he pressed his way. He denied himself the opportunity of holding on to it because he cared more about his Son than he cared about his pride. He cared more that his Son was dealt with and the problem was handled than he cared about holding on to the secret. Yes. He no longer had to safeguard it. He was now willing, ready, and able to surrender it. So he got his problem into the hands of Jesus.
Yes.
Now, this is a shout moment. Jesus, in the midst of a crowd, performed a private miracle. Jesus, in the midst of the crowd, performed a private miracle.
Yes.
While the crowd was still trying to figure out and come up and find out what was going on, Jesus, seeing the crowd coming, spoke to the demon, "Get out, don't come in here no more, you ain't allowed, I'm dealing with you once and for all."
Yes, yes.
And the boy falls down as if dead. Now, he's fallen down before, and I'm thinking that maybe others have seen this happen to him before, but this time it seemed to be a little different, because when he fell, they came up and looked at him and said, "Oh, he dead.
Jesus.
He dead." Sometimes, that thing that's been bothering you for so long, when you are willing, when you're ready, and when you're able, and you truly surrender it into the hands of Jesus, it ain't going to go out quietly.
Yes.
It's going to cause some sleepless nights. It's going to cause you to lose some rest. It's going to cause you to argue and debate. It's going to cause you to go back and forth with yourself. It's going to cause you to feel as if you're dead.
Yes, yes.
I've never known life outside of this. But now I've got to surrender this. I don't have that anymore. Now I feel as if something is missing. It takes my breath away. I feel as if I'm dead.
Jesus.
And those that witness it say he dead.
Yes.
It's over. How many times have people looked at your situation and said it's over?
Yes.
They dead in it.
Yes.
It got them this time. I didn't know for sure, but I'm looking at them and I know that it got them this time. They're dead. It's dealt with. It's over. But look at the love of our Jesus.
Yes, yes.
How he comes over, kneels down, takes the boy by his hand and raises him up. Don't you know that Jesus has all power and all authority? So not only did he speak to the situation of the boy, but he also spoke to the heart of the father. The father cries out with tears in his eyes. If you can, have compassion on me, on us. The father said us for a reason. You see, the father had linked himself to his son. What you are dealing with, I'm dealing with. What hurts you also hurts me. I don't want you to be separated from me. We're one. We're united. And I love you too much to allow you to go through this. Therefore, I'm taking me and you to Jesus.
Yes, yes.
Don't. My brother Rich says it this way. Don't die to your secret. When you're in a safe place where you can surrender it to Jesus, surrender it.
Yes.
Don't hold on to it. Don't take it back with you. Don't coddle it. Don't hold on to it for later. Surrender it. Because sooner or later, you're going to be looking and you're going to be dead. Don't die in your secrets. The father had so much love for his son that he said that I can't hold on to it. Jesus, heal us. Help us. Jesus, the loving father that he is, takes the young man by the hand and raises him up. Don't you know that there's nothing that can keep you from the Father? And even though it feels as if even though it sounds like, even though it's a scary moment, even though you weren't able to speak to it before, but you found the courage to come in and surrender it to Jesus. You found the courage to have voice over it now. And you're asking Jesus, you're saying, Jesus, just deal with it this time.
Yes, yes.
I know it's going to hurt, but Jesus, take it away from me this time. I've never been without it, but I'm ready to surrender it. Jesus, deal with it this time. It feels like it's going to kill me, but Jesus, deal with it this time.
Yes.
And Jesus deals with it. And there you are. Laid out before him at the altar, wondering what's going to happen next. And the loving father that he is extends his hand and raises you up. So in the midst of a crowd, God could perform a private miracle in your life. All you have to do is be willing to bring it before him and cry out, I believe, but Jesus, help my unbelief.
Yes. Yes.
Now I started off by saying that the little boy had no voice. The little boy had been speaking all along. The little boy had been trying to express himself all along. Every time the little boy tried, the demon would arrest him. What is it? What is it that's inside that little boy that the demon does not want heard? What is it? What is it that's causing that demon that's on assignment to destroy or to kill that little boy that he keeps silencing him? What is it in your life that's been keeping you quiet for so long and won't allow you to take the step to get closer to Jesus and surrender it to him? The text doesn't tell us, but the text does tell us that Jesus is able and that Jesus is capable and that Jesus wants to. All you got to do is be willing to surrender it.
Yes.
See, the little boy, like I said, was speaking all along. But he wasn't able to give tonation to make sounds other than what the demon had. Once the demon was out, the little boy was free to speak. Mm-hmm. Men, young women, not the ones in front of you, the ones inside of you. If you allow them to get into the presence of Jesus, get the help that's necessary. Let Jesus deal with that one inside of you. Let Jesus give voice to the one inside of you, that you don't have to be mentally chained back to that time. He can grow you up from the inside to equal the person that you become on the outside, mm-hmm. if you allow him to be your voice. So where's your voice? Where's your voice?